It's Ingegerd Kostenrazi, and you're listening to part 12 of Inge Reads the Marshal's Handbook, July 2020 edition. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, or complaints regarding this recording, please feel free to reach out to me. If you have any questions regarding the rules themselves, please check with your local kingdom guidelines, your local marshal, as well as the most up-to-date handbook for details. In this section, we will be covering equipment inspection guidelines, which begins on page 41 and ends on page 43. So Roman numeral 16, Roman numeral 16, equipment inspection guidelines. A, general information. 1. At each event, the marshal in charge must arrange for the inspection of all equipment to be used in combat, for example, armor and weapons. This in no way relieves the individual combatants of their responsibility for following the equipment standards. Ultimately, the fighter is responsible for the condition and safety of their armor and weapons at all times. This includes periods between bouts, between battles, and day-to-day periods between battles at a multi-day event. However, the marshal's inspection is intended to provide a second pair of experienced eyes and an outside point of view. A reminder, equipment that was perfectly serviceable at the beginning of the previous event could have broken since, and even the most experienced fighter can occasionally forget some piece of armor. The inspection outlined below is merely an example. For purposes of illustration, the inspection described is for regular SCA combat without missile weapons. It does not necessarily include checks for additional requirements that your kingdom may have added. A checklist might be helpful as you do the inspection until you have done so many that it becomes second nature. As noted in the section on marshaling combat, a quick visual check of the combatants just before the start of a bout or battle is also a good idea. All this is based on the equipment standards given in the appendix. You should be familiar with them, as well as with any other requirements that your kingdom may have instituted. The fact that one of the requirements is not mentioned on this checklist does not mean you should not notice if it has not been met. 2. Armor inspection must be done with all the armor on the body of the fighter who is going to wear it. It is not otherwise possible to get an accurate idea of what is covered and what is not, of where gaps may occur as a combatant moves. In weapon inspections, the primary test is safety. If you, as a marshal, do not believe that the weapon is safe, for example, you would not be willing to face it, do not let it be used on the field. When in doubt, ask the prospective user if he or she would be willing to fight against the weapon. If not, it should not be used, regardless of whether it meets all other requirements. Before you start, remind yourself that armor is hot, not to mention heavy. If the weather is hot, try to find some shade in which to hold the inspection, or at least for the fighters to stand in while waiting to be inspected. Similar reasoning applies in case of rain, freezing cold, or other inclement weather. Just because it is possible to fight does not mean that it is pleasant or desirable to stand around in armor. 3. As a marshal, you are not guaranteeing or certifying that anything is completely safe and its use is without risk. The primary responsibility for the safety of weapons and armor remains with the fighter. You are inspecting to see whether the item, helmet, armor, weapon, how the armor sits on the fighter, etc., complies with our published standards or not. If it does, it may be used in our combat activities. Otherwise, it may not. The purpose of our rules, standards, and inspections is to reduce the chance of injury for those who participate. Even with those rules and standards, all of our combat activities can lead to injury. Properly carrying out your duties as an officer of the SCA and a marshal will indemnify you in case the corporation or its officers, of which you are one, are sued. B. Sample armor inspection. See section Roman numeral 6, armor requirements, above for society minimum standards. 1. leg armor. Check that the front and sides of the knee are covered. If you are concerned about coverage during combat, have the fighter flex their knees, either a deep knee bend or raise one knee at a time, and see that the knee remains covered. Check for signs that the equipment is faulty. 2. Groin. Ask the fighter if they have remembered their cup or groin protection. Do not attempt to check for it physically. 3. Kidneys. Check for kidney armor. Kidneys are located in the back at the bottom of the ribs. 4. Elbows. Check that the point and sides of each elbow are covered. If you are concerned about coverage during combat, have the fighter flex their arm to validate that the elbow remains covered. Check for signs that the equipment is faulty. 5. Hands and wrists. Check the gauntlet and or basket hilt to see if they cover the required area, the hand and 1 inch of the forearm. Check for signs that the equipment is faulty. 6. Neck and head. A. Checks B through E below are to be conducted with the helmet on the fighter's head. B. Have the fighter assume their normal fighting stance. Check that the larynx and cervical vertebrae are covered. If it appears likely that the fighter's coverage for these areas will not remain in place when the fighter moves, you may have the fighter turn or tilt their head to typical combat positions to see that the required protections are in place. C. Check the faceplate and eye slots for greater than 1 inch openings that would allow weapon penetration. D. Put your hand on the front of the helm and have the fighter push against it. See that their face does not hit the faceplate. A gentle touch of the tip of the nose to the faceplate at maximum pressure is undesirable, but not grounds to disqualify the helm. E. Lift gently on the front of the faceplate to make sure that the chin strap is secured. F. Have the fighter to remove their head protection and inspect the interior for broken welds, internal projections that could cause injury, and the presence and condition of padding or a suspension system. Padding must be a minimum of 1/2 inch or 12.7 millimeters of closed cell foam or equivalent padding, or the helmet shall be suspended in such a way as to prevent contact with the wearer during combat. Padding and suspension systems degrade over time with use and wear and may need to be repaired or replaced. 7. Shield. Check the rim for exposed sharp edges. For this purpose, a 90-degree angle is a sharp edge. Check the rest of the shield for sharp edges, broken or missing rivets, or other signs that it is faulty. C. Sample weapon inspection. C-section Roman numeral 7, weapon standards, above for society minimum standards. 1. Swords. A. Check that they meet the minimum diameter, 1.25 inches, or 31.8 millimeters. A 1.25 inch or 31.8 millimeter marshaling gauge will speed this up enormously. B. Check that the ends are taped and that there are no exposed cuts in the rattan. C. Check the quillions or basket hilts for sharp edges, broken or missing rivets, or other signs that they are coming apart. D. Check the wrist strap or other means of keeping the sword from flying away. 2. Thrusting tips. Check that they have the minimum cross section. Push on the end to verify the required amount of resilient give. Check that the tip is constructed in such a manner that cannot be forced more than 1/2 inch or 12.7 millimeters into a legal face guard. 3. Mass weapons. Check the padding for give. Check the wrist strap. Single-handed mass weapons only. Consider the total mass of the weapon. 4. Pole weapons. Check the thrusting tip, if any. Check the padding for give. Consider the total mass of the weapon. Check that the weapon meets the relevant length restrictions. D. Sample combat archery inspection. 1. Bow or crossbow. Ensure that the string is not showing excessive wear. B. Measure the power of the bow with a calibrated scale to ensure it is within appropriate specs. C. Check the bow itself for cracks or gouges, as well as for significant limb twists that could make the string leave the tips. 2. Crossbow only. Check that the lock mechanism releases smoothly under simulated pressure. 2B. Check that the lock mechanism is solid and will not accidentally fire. 2C. Ensure the stock has no failures between the bow and lock. 3. Ammunition. Based upon the type of ammunition, measure all dimensions for conformance. 3B. With two fingers and a thumb, grab both head and tail and pull it with moderate force while slightly twisting. If either end moves laterally, it fails. C. If the ammunition is made with foam, check that the tip is constructed in such a manner that it cannot be forced more than half an inch or 12.7 millimeters into a legal face guard. D. If the blunt is commercially manufactured, ensure it is in good repair. E. Check the shaft and APD, if applicable, for signs of cracking or other failure. If a marshal can place a fingernail in a defect, then it fails. F. Check that the weapon is properly labeled and taped. Now, this ends part 12 of Equipment Inspection Guidelines. I'm going to read Experimental Weapons and Materials Procedures separately. You can go ahead and follow up with that in part 13 in this video series if you wish. And as always, if you have any comments, questions, concerns, or complaints regarding the recording itself of this reading, you may contact me, Ingegerd Kasenrazi. I hail from the Kingdom of Atlantia. And again, if you have any questions regarding the rules themselves, please check with your local kingdom guidelines, your Earl Marshal or local marshal, and the most up-to-date handbook. And as always, I hope you have a great day.